The applications for industrial-grade mixers are limitless. From construction and recycling to food processing and medical supplies. Mixers chop, crush, and blend any combination of dry and wet materials into a variety of products or compounds. This mixer consists of a bin called a U-trough and an agitator. It's controlled by an interface module with simple start and stop buttons. The agitator shaft is the main component. Its arms and paddles turn at a speed of 10 to 50 rotations per minute. A discharge valve underneath the U-trough controls the unloading of the mixture. First, a hydraulic 40-ton press roll forms a carbon steel sheet. The sheet rolls back and forth under the press until it takes a U-shape. An overhead crane brings the sheet over to the end plate for welding. A worker spot welds the sheet to the end plate. Then he makes a continuous weld on the end plate along the inside and outside of the sheet. A high-definition plasma cutter burns paddle shapes into a stainless steel plate. The extreme heat of the plasma cuts right through the steel, making very precise lines and angles. Then the paddles go to a forming press. The 150-ton press pushes the plate down on a die. Steel is a formable metal, so it can bend without cracking or breaking. A slight curvature in the paddles will maximize the lifting and scooping effect of the agitator. A machinist turns the agitator main shaft. It takes a very hard and resistant material to machine such a massive steel shaft. This tungsten carbide insert can resist high temperatures and maintain a sharp cutting edge. The machinist measures the diameter. He cuts a groove into the end of the shaft using a stagger tooth side mill cutter. This groove, called a key seat, is designed to lock the agitator to the mixer's drive gearbox. Machining of the agitator requires extreme precision. The shaft must fit into the drive gearbox and match its drive key slot. A worker assembles arms and paddles to an agitator shaft mounted inside a U-trough. He bolts the arms onto the shaft. He tightens the nuts with a pneumatic torque driver and assembles paddles to the arms. Both the paddles and arms are angled. Machine slots in the paddles allow clearance adjustment. Next, a worker rotates the assembled shaft and arms to check the clearance between the paddles and U-trough walls. A welder creates a solid stainless steel agitator shaft for a larger mixer. He welds the base of the arms to the shaft and grinds down the welding profile to obtain a uniform shape. Welded agitators are often used in food processing because they make cleaning easier. Now, workers attach an electric motor to the mixer. They mount the drive assembly on the agitator shaft. A taper bushing centers the drive gearbox on the shaft. Fasteners secure the bushing in place, locking the agitator shaft into the drive. A worker installs a safety grate on top of the mixer and closes the covers. Then he installs air pressure regulators. These supply air to the main shaft seals. Air purge seals prevent product loss or contamination. Air lines connect the pressure regulators to both ends of the main shaft agitator. The mixer fits on a support frame for easy access to the discharge valve. It's equipped with clamps, safety latches, and a control panel, which includes an emergency stop button. When an 18-wheeler has an accident, or construction equipment breaks down, you need to call in the big guns to haul it away for repair. Large tow trucks are equipped with specialized tools to recover and transport massive vehicles. This tow truck can haul a vehicle as large as a semi-truck. The towing apparatus is called the underlift. This is one of four outriggers. These legs stabilize the tow truck when it's using the recovery boom. This extendable boom is equipped with dual wire ropes and hooks to retrieve a vehicle that's gone off the road. These hydraulically powered towing and recovery machines are made up of 2,500 parts cut from steel sheets. The parts are cut by one of two types of computer-guided machines, a high-pressure water jet cutter, as we're seeing here, or a laser cutter. Workers position the parts in an assembly fixture, then tack weld them together. Tack welding is an initial welding in select spots, just to hold the parts together until a robot does the final welding. Next, workers sandblast the welded component. This preps the surface for painting. They apply one coat of epoxy primer, then one coat of polyurethane automotive paint. The paint dries in about 2 hours and fully cures in about 2 days. Workers hook up all of the hydraulically powered components to this testing machine. If everything functions properly, workers connect permanent hydraulic lines. To assemble the recovery boom, they install hydraulic cylinders that will move it up and down, a winch that winds and unwinds the thick wire ropes, and an enormous ring gear that enables the boom to rotate 360 degrees. Then they attach the extendable boom. It's secured with massive steel pins. Workers also attach the underlift at the back and the four stabilizing outriggers underneath. This completes the towing and recovery unit. Now they attach it to a pre-built truck. Steel mounting plates are bolted to the truck's frame. The towing and recovery unit is then welded to those plates. Workers bolt aluminum tool cabinets to the side of the truck's frame. Inside the cabinet, they make the wiring connections for the emergency lights and other electrical components. They install the electronic control panel that the driver uses to operate everything. The control panel monitors oil temperature, hydraulic pressure, and other important indicators. They also install a set of control handles to give the driver the option of manual operation. Once everything's hooked up, they perform a quality control inspection. This factory makes several models, ranging from a light-duty tow truck to one like this, designed to haul the heaviest trucks and machinery.